The hype is real. Amazon Prime Video just released the second trailer, this time live on the Dusty Wheel. There was so much new stuff packed into this trailer that people are talking about all over the internet. I can barely contain my excitement. So join me in today's video as we break down the clip frame by frame and point out all the Easter eggs, characters, plot, general cool shit that's happening in the second trailer from Amazon's Wheel of Time TV series. Now, all right, before we dive into the trailer, let me first thank the video sponsor, Audible.com. Audible is the world's largest provider of audiobooks, and the Wheel of Time audiobooks just happen to be awesome. Kate Redding and Michael Kramer do an amazing job with the books. Also, Rosamund Pike just recorded Eye of the World on audiobook, and you are going to be able to get that on Audible as well. It's a super low monthly cost, and you get a book a month rather than paying a ton of money for individual audiobooks. The great news is that you can get a free audiobook just for being a viewer of the channel. Just head to www.audibletrial.com/Nablus and sign up for the free trial. You get to keep the book whether you keep the service or not. It is literally free. Go check it out. Let's also hit the spoiler warning for the video. Today's video is going to carry a spoiler rating of red, with major spoilers through The Shadow Rising and New Spring, the prequel novel. If you do not want to be spoiled on those books and the books leading up to that, watch this video at your own risk. You have been warned. Now, all right, just as with my other breakdowns, you can see what I like and what I don't like in the patented Nablus eggplant rating system in the top left. You'll figure it out. So, without further ado, let's break down the second trailer from Amazon's Wheel of Time TV show. So we open with this shot of Moraine wearing a white dress and a voiceover saying, "Swear your oath, Moraine Sedai." Now this voice is that of Sophie Accanato playing Swan Sanche, and we also get to see these shots of Moraine standing before the Hall of the Tower, and then her hand on what is very clearly the oath rod being held by Swan as she channels. Now there's a couple things worth pointing out in this sequence. First of all, the opening shot with Moraine in the white could be her as an accepted, echoing back to when she first swore her oaths. We'll come back to this because we again are going to see her in white. Then we get Moraine wearing this formal blue dress, and it's the very same dress as when she stands before the hall and when she's holding the oath rod, which begs the question, why is she holding the oath rod here and what is she swearing? Now, one explanation is that this is her being sworn as an Aes Sedai, but I don't think so. She's with the exact same group of Aes Sedai as in the other clips, and Swan is supposedly her age, so having Swan be the Ammerlin and then swearing her in would not make much sense unless they change Swan's age. My guess is that this is part of the plot to throw people off of what Moraine is actually doing. My working theory here is that Moraine is in trouble for something to do with Loghain and his escape, or the fact that maybe he killed another Aes Sedai, and people are curious why she went to the Two Rivers. This may be some form of punishment of sorts, but we know she's also in on it with Swan, so this could be the public cover for the two of them. There is something we don't know, which is certainly adding to the mystery. I really hope this is some elaborate ruse and political game being played by Swan and Moraine. I want to see them play up those elements in the show. One other possibility is that there is suspicion of someone being a dark friend letting Loghain go, and they are making all of them re-swear the oaths, but Leandrin does not appear to be squirming at all here, and I doubt they introduced that element this early. The next couple shots are still set to the voiceover of Moraine swearing the three oaths. The clips correspond to her saying she won't use the One Power as a weapon as she proceeds in the clips to use the One Power as a weapon. Now, before anyone freaks out, I do believe that they did not change the three oaths. They just cut off the rest of the last oath to make the clip shorter. It should have read, "not to use the One Power as a weapon except against Shadowspawn, or in the defense of your own life or that of your warder." That would have been a mouthful, so they probably cut that part off. Rafe actually mentions it in his commentary, so I don't think they're cutting it. Moraine is standing here channeling in front of Leandrin and Alana, who appear to be concentrating deeply with their eyes closed. This appears to be the same area that we saw Loghain caged in before, but it's difficult to place the timing as these chairs are intact, and we know that one of them is destroyed when Loghain blows off his bonds that we saw in the other trailer. We then cut to the shot of Loghain in his cage. He also seems to either be concentrating, sleeping, or meditating, something like that. This is the same cage we saw him throw off his shield and fling Leandrin and Kareen from their chairs in the last trailer. Perhaps this happens right before that. We then cut back to this shot of Moraine channeling, but this is not the same scene as the last one. This is the same cave, and you can tell by the light fixtures being the same and the overall appearance of the cave, but this right here is Kareen standing up, and this is her broken chair back here. This is one of the promotional shots we also saw in the GQ article last week. So it appears that Corrine did not die when she got flung into the column. Now in this shot, Moraine appears to be concentrating on Loghain as Corrine recovers. I would say that she's attempting to hold him, and this is right after Loghain flung Corrine and Liandrin back. We see Liandrin stepping into the frame here as well, her hands up ready to fight. Now I love her channeling stance being different for Moraine and more combative. She almost looks as though she's about to do some sort of martial arts on Loghain, but we know it's the channel. I love that distinction and I love how combative she is. We then cut to this clip of Steppen, played by Peter Franzen, who is Corrine Nagashi's warder. Now he's asking someone off camera if they know what Aes Sedai means in the old tongue. I do love Peter Franzen, he's amazing, so I think this is a really cool role for him. My guess is that he is talking to Nynaeve here, as we see that she is with this party from the previous trailers, and I doubt he would be asking another of the Aes Sedai if they know what Aes Sedai means. We then cut back to these shots of the Hall of the Tower being seated, presumably after the Amelin has seated herself. Now Moraine stands in front of her with Liandrin and Alana at her side, flanked by these red sisters that we know were at the fight with Loghain, and these green sisters here. Now notice that there is a green sitter absent, and Corrine Nagashi is absent. I think it's possible that Corrine was a sitter, and in her death or absence is part of the reason it looks like these Aes Sedai are being chastised, Moraine at the center of it. Now you'll notice I said being seated and not standing up. Nablus, you might ask. They look to be standing up here in this shot, and I would tell you that this clip has actually been reversed. Watch this Aes Sedai right here. See how she holds her dress as though she's about to sit? I think the frame is reversed and they are actually all sitting at this point. We'll come back to this here later. Now the voiceover from Steppen continues saying that Aes Sedai means servants of all, and that they serve the world while showcasing the Aes Sedai. This is clearly meant for new viewers to have an idea of who the Aes Sedai are in the show. So far, the Aes Sedai and the Three Oaths have been the main feature and theme of the trailer, showing how central Aes Sedai are going to be to the story. Now that's something I like, because I think the intrigue and sheer power of the women of the Aes Sedai will draw in new fans. People love that political intrigue, and Aes Sedai have tons of it. Now the books go there eventually. They bring in all that political intrigue and all that, but with the adapted story, it looks like we're gonna get more Aes Sedai sooner, which I think is cool. We then cut to the shot of Moraine standing in what is presumably the White Tower. This echoes the shot we saw in the other trailer and is likely to be the same shot, unless Moraine is going to pull a Cersei Lannister and look out windows off balconies for most of the show. Notice in this scene that Moraine is wearing her Kysera, the same as in the previous scene where she stands before the hall. So this balcony scene either comes before or after that, almost as though she's waiting for judgment for something. Again, feeding back into that idea that she's about to be chastised. Now the voiceover on this section is Moraine saying that she did not choose this path, but she will follow it. There's strong foreshadowing in the mission from her being raised to Aes Sedai. We are getting strong indications that there are going to be flashbacks to her time in the tower as an accepted, where she learned of the dragon being reborn. We have evidence of this later, which we'll get to. We move to this scene of Lan asking Moraine where next, and she replies, the Two Rivers, saying that the old blood runs deep in these mountains, as we see a procession of women circle members marching across a beautiful landscape. Now, according to Rafe's commentary, this shot is completely the landscape that was actually shot there. There's no CGI, which is absolutely incredible. I love shots like this. Again, it's very reminiscent of Lord of the Rings. The procession of the women is likely moving towards the women's circle ceremony for Egwene, as that's been heavily foreshadowed and talked about, and then further backed up as we move into this next shot of Egwene in the pool, prior to the women's circle throwing the paint at her. Based on the previous trailer, this is where that ceremony will take place. Notice how as Moraine talks about the old blood being strong, it focuses on the characters that we know are strong in the old blood and have great power, that they just don't know about yet. Moraine even foreshadows this by saying that she hopes it has them prepared for what is coming. And then we see shots of Egwene, Nynaeve, Rand, Perrin, and Matt, basically the five most powerful characters in the series. We then cut to this rider moving into the village. I think the implication here is that this is the Myrdral, but I'm not so sure. After seeing Moraine and Lan coming in from the rain in the clip they released, I think this is more likely to be one of them. This is evidenced by the lack of any of the lights or decorations for the Beltane celebration that we see in the other shot of the Two Rivers, specifically the battle shots. I think this is a very deceiving cut. I think they want us to think that's the Myrdral. I don't think it is. Now we do get this very short glimpse of the Myrdral that we've seen before, and this actually looks more human here. Very pasty white skin. You could just see the lips there. It's very much how they're described in the books. I love this shot. We then cut to this shot of the group entering what is probably Shadar Logoth. We have Lan, Matt, Egwene, and what appears to be Moraine in this shot. I absolutely love the sets and the creepy lighting that they've got going on for Shadar Logoth. I really think that set is going to be scary. This shot here pans to Egwene and Rand and this guy here. This appears to be the Two Rivers, and my guess is this is right as they're about to depart the village. You can see by Egwene's wounds that they have not really had time to clean up after the fight. This shot is of Perrin in what I would guess is Fal'Dara. He's wearing very different clothing than we've seen him in before, so I'm not really sure what this shot would be of, but I do think it's Fal'Dara. This is a closer shot of Nynaeve doing her braid swing from the previous clips that we've seen. I absolutely love the look of this and the look on her face. Now, obviously, Nynaeve is either fighting or doing something intense here, based on that look on her face. In Rafe's commentary in this scene, he mentions that she has just done something pretty incredible, in his words, and this braid tug or flip is not only one of strength, but also defiance. If I had to guess where this was from, just knowing the books, I'd say this is likely the scene where she frees Egwene and Perrin from the White Cloaks. This shot is of Matt pulling a dagger on someone. Now this is the Shadar Logoth dagger here, and the look on Matt's face is kind of one of paranoia. I wonder if this is him pulling the dagger on someone that doesn't deserve it, maybe like Tom, just being paranoid, just a thought. This shot is of Rand shooting his bow at what I believe is Fal'Dara. This actually appears to be a scene from the leaked set pictures of the filming that showed Rand shooting his bow. He was wearing this shirt and he was standing at an archery range with Trolloc dummies. You can also see the structure of the fort behind him, so he's probably preparing for some type of a fight. Now let's quickly talk about what Moraine is saying here as these scenes have been flashing across the screen. She is talking about how the Dark One is breaking free, but one has been born that can stand against him, and it's one of the five of them, as she references Nynaeve, Rand, Matt, Egwene, and Perrin. Now let's address the controversy here that really should not be a controversy. Moraine is not telling a lie here. She is saying that it is one of the five of them, and it is. She may even know it's one of the boys. I will tell you one thing that I keep seeing people bring up that they are not doing. No, Egwene is not going to be the Dragon Reborn. They are simply playing up the mystery in the marketing. There is a absolute 0% chance that that change is being made. I will leave it at that. But in terms of Moraine's words, I love them. This is very, very Aes Sedai of her. She clearly wants the boys to leave and the girls to come too. She can likely feel their strength as channelers by saying, it's one of the five of you. She's telling the truth while letting them come to their own conclusions. Now, I will throw one wrinkle in everyone's thoughts here, though. Moraine says, it's one of the five of you. Yet as we cut to the next shot, we clearly don't see Nynaeve with them. And what we also see here is likely the same scene, and there are only three boys and Egwene. Are we 100% sure that the fifth person Moraine is referring to is Nynaeve? If so, why doesn't Nynaeve come with them at first, but then obviously join them later? That doesn't make sense. I actually have another theory, and I actually think I'm pretty right here. I think she actually says four of you here. First of all, you do not see her mouth move when she says the number five in this clip. And keep in mind, she is talking to four different people here. Second, the clips were shown at the Comic-Con in London, and they showed this actual scene, and the people who watched it said that she did not say five. I think this is the Wheel of Time marketing team playing games with people, trying to play up a mystery. This is something that's super common in trailers, so don't get all up in a bind about it, and I think they're doing it right here. Here we get a shot of Matt asking someone off camera, implied to be Moraine, if they have fully lost their mind. He may not be addressing Moraine here. Keep in mind that they do tricky things when editing together a trailer, and typically we're not seeing continuous dialogue, although I think we're meant to think he's saying that to Moraine, which he could be. We then get this beautiful shot of the group of them sitting on what looks like a cliffside. This is likely sometime after they have left the Two Rivers, but obviously before they are separated. I love these shots though, again, these giant cinematic epic shots, I love them. And now we move to this shot of the absolute wreckage of the village and of the Winespring Inn in the background. Literally half the inn is completely destroyed and there are dead bodies everywhere. I absolutely love that the village is really going to feel this attack. This is gonna be traumatic and devastating and I love it. It makes these events far more impactful. And just as they are likely talking about leaving, we hear these horns and Lan gets Moraine's attention as Egwene asks, what are those? And it's more Trollocs headed down from the mountains towards the village. This is likely the reason that Moraine is able to get them to leave so quickly. I actually like this rather than the group leaving for the hypothetical reason that Moraine was right. Seeing more Trollocs coming would certainly be a clear motivator that it is time to go. We then cut to the shot of Trollocs running through the woods. I would imagine this is part of the same sequence. It's just getting lighter outside as the sun's coming up. And then we get this Trolloc roaring. I love the look of this. They are legitimate monsters and they look it. They are physically imposing, which becomes more obvious as we move into this next shot at the Althor farmhouse. This here is Tam and Rand standing as a Trolloc busts through the door. Is this the TV show version of Narg? Either way, the Trolloc is absolutely massive and horrifying. We get a quick shot of Perrin asking what they can do, which based on the background and the shirt he's wearing, I think is also likely still at Faldara. Then we go back to the Althor farm where we see Tam show some signs that he's actually a badass. He unsheathed the Heron Mark sword and we see him block a massive swing from a Trolloc. Look at that face. Tell me that does not look amazing. The Trollocs look really, really good. These shots between this scene where the Trolloc is locked up with Tam and this next clip with Rand firing an arrow in the house are not in sequence, but I think they likely are part of the same fight. Look at that look on Rand's face. He is likely seeing two things. One, the first time he's seeing a Trolloc, which he likely did not even believe was real before this. And then he's likely seeing Tam fight with a sword for the first time and wondering what that is all about. As I said, Yosha's strength as an actor, in my opinion, is his ability to act with his facial expressions, and you see that right here. Now here we get a scene of someone riding quickly through the forest, likely Lan. Not much context to the scene, but it's beautifully shot. This here is Lan laying Moraine down to rest or recover from a wound. My guess is this is after the Shadar Logoth scenes and likely in the same sequence that Nynaeve will catch up with them and that Lan will confront her as she pulls a knife on him. We saw this in the previous trailer. We then cut to a shot of Egwene sitting at a table saying, "No matter the cost," to some people off screen. You can see Nynaeve looking on at her. What I love about this is how determined and strong Egwene is. Whatever they are debating, she seems to be leading the charge in the debate. Then we cut to this shot of a fortress, which Rafe confirmed to be Faldara. I love this shot, and I think there's a lot to pick out of it. Right here is Tarwyn's Gap, and very likely the Blight in the background, and probably what's left of Melkir. Faldara in the books is essentially a large military fort town that guards Tarwyn's Gap, or is at least near Tarwyn's Gap. This shot is a combination of a couple shots, though. The landscape shots were of some filming locations in the Canary Islands, and the fort itself comes from Terezin. In fact, this bridge is pulled directly from that filming location. Now, I love the attention to detail. According to Rafe's commentary, these people here are actually real extras, just filmed at a distance. It also shows the scale of the fort, which I think is awesome. In this next shot, we see Moraine and Lan being led through some doors to a figure staring off a balcony. Now, this is in Faldara, and this person right here is Lord Agomar. Behind him, you can see Tarwyn's Gap, and he appears to be staring out into the gap. Now, this is certainly foreboding. As we know in the books, they are expecting an attack by Shadowspawn, and likely a battle will ensue in the next days. Here we get a closer shot of what is likely Agomar from the same shot. I love the feudal Japanese themes they appear to be going with on the costuming. This is always how I envisioned Shinarin, so it's really cool to see them reflect my own headcanon. Next, we get this shot of a woman being burned alive at a stake, which is quite a change in theme from Faldara, and this is certainly very dark indeed. Now, if you were unsure who this woman was from this shot, the next clip might give you some idea. We move to this shot of Abdul Salis, who's playing Aemon Valda. Now, a couple things in this shot. First, notice the reflection on the cup. This is the same burning woman being reflected. So he is literally sitting down to eat and drink and watch a woman get burned alive at the stake. If that isn't straight up evil, I'm not sure what is. He even has a smirk on his face, which shows how much delight he takes in this. Now remember, Aemon Valda is not in Eye of the World, but he is not a good dude, and I think they are leaning into that pretty heavily here, as evidenced by this. The White Cloaks are certainly going to be portrayed as bad guys in the first season. Also in this shot, notice the blood on his fingers and on the cloth sitting there on the table. This certainly implies some type of stabbing or wound, but I have a theory here that will become more obvious in a second. Because in the very next shot, you see Valda walking away from an area behind him that is smoking, implying the fire. You see the same blood on his hands and on this Aes Sedai ring here, which happens to be yellow, like the lady's clothing was that was being burned. My theory is this is an Aes Sedai being burned alive by the White Cloaks, and Valda has cut the ring off her hand while she was tied up. You can see other Aes Sedai rings at his waist, implying he makes it his goal to kill as many as possible. Now this certainly makes the White Cloaks really, really awful, which I absolutely love. I have a feeling we are going to love to hate Aemon Valda. So, it does beg the question though, how the White Cloaks were able to capture an Aes Sedai to burn her alive. Killing her is possible from what we know. You can shoot an Aes Sedai with an arrow, but how could they have incapacitated an Aes Sedai to burn her alive? Possibly the use of Forkroot? We'll have to wait and find out. We next move to this clip of Lan screaming in pain or sadness. This is the biggest sign of emotion that we get from Lan in any of the clips that we've seen so far, and it would take something pretty painful to make him give this kind of reaction. You can see Moraine shedding a tear, likely feeling whatever pain Lan is going through the bond. Behind Moraine here, we have Nynaeve and Alana, all of them dressed in white. My guess is that this is a funeral of some sort and it's taking place in Faldara. It's not a flashback because we can see Nynaeve in the frame here. My guess is that this is someone Lan cares about, maybe Agomar, Ubukama, or another Malkyrie that they're creating for the story that helped raise Lan, that died fighting Shadowspawn, and this is a funeral or mourning scene. We move to the shot of Rand walking through the village with Tam on Bella's back as the village is devastated from the Trolloc attack, while a voiceover of Rand saying, "We've lost too many people already," and then, "I can't lose you." Presumably talking to Egwene, as the last few shots we get Egwene saying, "You won't." Based on the clothing that he's wearing here and the torches in the background, I would say that this is likely Faldara, and the scene takes place around the same time that Rand was practicing with his bow that we saw earlier in the trailer. This next shot, we have Perrin and Egwene surrounded by three white cloaks and a man in a colored shirt laying on the ground near them. This is Aurum right here. There's a strong implication that the White Cloaks will attack the Tinker camp that Egwene and Perrin are staying at. Now we move to this quick shot of a man sliding a knife out of his jacket with a blurred background. Now could this be Tom Marilyn sliding out a dagger? We're gonna come back to this one. We then cut to this shot of a Trolloc attacking Egwene and Nynaeve, most likely on Winter Night. Look at this Trolloc. That is amazing special effects work. These look horrifying. I love it. We get to see Egwene smack that Trolloc with some wood. Not sure what that's gonna do, but go girl. We then cut to a scene of the Waygate again and Moraine walking towards it as everyone stands around waiting, ready to go. Now, this is likely our very first Loyal sighting right here. He appears to be hunched over in this shot, but I am so happy that we finally got to see him. And here we get a very quick shot of a man in black that I think is probably a Mergeral fighting Tom Marilyn, who is holding a dagger. Notice, first of all, the cuffs on Tom's shirt. These appear to be the same as the previous shot with the dagger coming out of the sleeves. Second, look at that Mergeral's sword. It is covered in blood, implying that he has already killed someone or maybe even stabbed Tom's leg. Now we get a shot of Nynaeve running away from something and then some shots of the Trolloc attack on Winter Night, which appears to be absolutely ferocious. Again, look at this Trolloc. I literally love the way these look. They did such a good job with these. I'm amazed at how well they came out. Finally, we see Moraine channeling something other than white smoky stuff. Here we have her throwing fireballs at Trollocs, and I am here for it. This battle scene is going to look super epic. One of these Trollocs right here looks to have like a beak-like feature, so I love that there's variation between them. They're not all like minotaurs. Some of them had bird beaks. I love that attention to detail. The next shot is of Loghain melting away his cage with the One Power. This is presumably after he has blown off his shield and thrown Leandrin and Kareen from their chairs. I love the black wisps coming up from the bars as they melt as well. Next we get this shot of somebody trying to stab Loghain and him stopping it with the One Power. Now, there's a couple things of note here. First, look at the black wisps intermixed with the white One Power. Rafe confirmed that this is actually what he is calling the corruption, RIP taint. This does actually better explain why they chose to make the One Power purely white, at this point at least. It makes it easier to see the corruption of the One Power when channeled by men. Another thing of note in this shot is the dagger. You see these three stars? That is the sigil of Gildan. So this may be the king or some representative of the king trying to stab Loghain. Here we get a shot of Alana just blowing shit up with the One Power. There were a lot of what we believe are Dragonsworn attacking in another shot similar to this earlier in another trailer, so this is likely her defending herself and her two warders from them. We then cut to another shot of some Trollocs moving in the streets, and then a quick shot of what appear to be Shinarin soldiers aiming crossbows. Now the way this is edited, this would lead you to believe that they are pointing them at the Trollocs, but I think that the Trolloc scene is actually in the Two Rivers and was a part of the Winter Night attack. The Shinarins are in, well, Shinar. So who are they aiming at? I think it's likely that these are guards at the Faldara Keep, we may see a giant battle at Faldara. I think it's actually more likely that we see an attack on the keep rather than a staged battle out in Tarwyn's Gap in the open. I think given the location of the keep in relation to Tarwyn's Gap, which is far closer in the TV show than it is in the books, it's likely that to defend the gap, they only have to stay inside the walls at Faldara. So that's my guess. Also, budget-wise, it's going to be a lot easier to show people attacking a castle than it would be giant open battlefields. So, my guess, we see a large-scale Shadowspawn attack on Faldara, which I am all for. And then we come to the money shot of this trailer, in my opinion. We see an Aiel running through the snow with blood on it, hint, hint. They also appear to be fighting at the base of a mountain, given the background. There are dead bodies everywhere, wagons turned over, and look at those bloody spears. And the next shot has all kinds of speculation going. We see an Aiel grabbing the cloak of a soldier and flinging them about. Now, a couple things on this. First of all, this appears to be an Ilionar soldier, given the sigil of the golden bees on the breastplate. Now, I've seen a ton of speculation that this is Tam, but I don't believe that it is. See the hair? It's long and dark and seemingly curly. I don't think that matches what we've seen of Tam in the trailers. I think this is obviously an Ilionar soldier, and it's possible that this is a part of the scene where Tam does find Rand on the slopes of Dragonmount after this battle. We then see a couple quick shots before the end of the trailer in a shot of Loghain, a shot of Rand aiming his bow with a pained look on his face, and then a shot of Swan Sanche ascending up to the Ammerlin Sea. In this last shot, notice all the Aes Sedai are standing. This further backs up the notion that the Aes Sedai were not standing in the earlier shot, but rather sitting down after the Ammerlin was seated. But that's it. That's my breakdown of the trailer. What did you guys think of this trailer? Did this get you more or less excited? Let me know what you think in the comments of the video. Make sure also to like the video and subscribe to the channel to get more Wheel of Time content. That is all I do here, and I'll say this, we have a ton of really exciting stuff coming up here in the very near future. You do not want to miss any of it. Trust me on that. Make sure you are subscribed. Thanks again to the sponsor of the video, audible.com. Go get your free audiobook, and special thanks to my patrons over on Patreon, you who make all of this possible. Without your support, it would be very difficult to keep going with how crazy life can get. From the bottom of my heart, thank you. Thank you everybody for watching, and until next time, peace out.